Welcome to the Watchman Channel. This channel is all about world news and Bible prophecy, pointing to the soon return of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I am asking that if you can, to please help to financially support this ministry. If you feel led to pledge any amount of money, it would be extremely helpful and greatly appreciated. There is a PayPal link in the description box and in my pinned comment below. You can also donate using Cash App. My cash tag is $Watchman1963. Thank you all so much for your prayers and support. God bless. America is in a spiritual battle between good and evil, as we read in Ephesians 6:12, where we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places.
We turn now to that new Louisiana law requiring the Ten Commandments to be displayed in every public school classroom.
Whatever your knowledge of or adherence to the Ten Commandments, those ethical imperatives inherent to Judaism and Christianity, if you're in a Louisiana public school classroom, they're going to be up on the wall. That, according to a new Louisiana law requiring the Ten Commandments to be displayed in every public classroom in the state from kindergarten all the way through state-funded universities by the start of 2025.
If you want to respect the rule of law, you got to start from the original lawgiver, which was Moses.
The commandments must be on a poster-sized display with, quote, easily readable font and include a four-paragraph context statement detailing how the Ten Commandments were, quote, a prominent part of American public education for almost three centuries, according to the legislation drafted by the Louisiana GOP. Opponents say it's unconstitutional, that it's an egregious melding of church and state.
We learned the Ten Commandments. We went to Sunday school. And as I said on the Senate floor, if you want your kids to learn the Ten Commandments, you can take them to church.
Supporters say the purpose of the measure is not solely religious, that the Ten Commandments have historical significance.
And well, this is going to face immediate legal challenges.
The ACLU plans to sue, arguing this law will make kids of different religious beliefs feel unsafe, saying politicians have no business imposing their preferred religious doctrine on students and families in public schools. Under the law, the state funds won't be used for the commandment displays. They'll be paid for by donations.
Previous efforts to require the Ten Commandments to be displayed in public schools have been shut down by the Supreme Court. Legislators this time around hope that any suit brought before the Supreme Court would be met more favorably by its conservative majority. Currently, similar bills have been proposed in Texas, Oklahoma, and Utah, but thus far, Louisiana is the only state to successfully turn such a bill into law.
I hope and I pray that Louisiana is the first state to allow moral code to be placed back in the classrooms.
God is being expelled from the essence of American society. Through Supreme Court decisions starting in 1962, God is being expelled from America. 1962, Engel versus Vital. The removal of prayer in public schools by the Supreme Court. 1963, Abington School District versus Shemp. The removal of Bible reading in public schools by the Supreme Court. Contrary to the Lord's commands, America has made it illegal to teach about God and to pray to Him in public schools. When God led the Israelites out of bondage, He commanded them to teach their children all He had done for them, as we read in Deuteronomy 6:6-7. And these words, which I command you today, shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. God desired that the generations to come would continue to uphold all His commands. When one generation fails to instill God's laws in the next, a society quickly declines.
2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Jesus said, as a sign of His coming and the end of the age, there would be an increase in deception, false Christs who will deceive many, wars and rumors of wars, nation against nation and kingdom against kingdom, famines, pestilences, earthquakes, Christian persecution, apostasy, false prophets, and lawlessness, causing the love of many to grow cold. Jesus said all of these signs would come like birth pains. Jesus was likening last day's events to a woman in labor. As the labor progresses, the pains increase in both frequency and intensity until the baby finally comes. As we get closer to Jesus' return, all the signs he gave us as a sign of his coming and the end of the age will become more frequent and more intense. All of these signs are manifesting around the world in our time. In the last days, the prophet Zechariah tells us Israel will be the focal point of world conflict, and he gives a dire warning to the nations who would dare come against Jerusalem. Zechariah 12:2-3. Behold, I will make Jerusalem a cup of drunkenness to all the surrounding peoples when they lay siege against Judah and Jerusalem. And it shall happen in that day that I will make Jerusalem a very heavy stone for all peoples. All who would heave it away will surely be cut in pieces, though all nations of the earth are gathered against it. This prophecy is unfolding right before our very eyes.
We're going to turn to Israel, where U.S. arms shipments are in process. Israeli leaders say the Biden administration has confirmed that it's not holding up any weapons.
Meanwhile, Hezbollah's leader is promising a fight, quote, without rules, if Israel declares an all-out war on the terrorist army.
The Israeli government says it's received assurances from the U.S. that there is no holdup in weapon shipments. Earlier this week, Prime Minister Netanyahu said the U.S. is withholding the arms it needs to fight. Wednesday, a post on a social media page for the Prime Minister's office said the U.S. ambassador to Israel told Netanyahu that the weapons are in process of being sent. A spokesman for the Israeli government repeated that message.
Ammunition and weapons that the Prime Minister referred to are in the process of being delivered to Israel.
A delegation of U.S. Congress members met with Netanyahu and Israeli President Herzog yesterday. Herzog says such squabbles shouldn't be allowed to fray the crucial U.S.-Israeli alliance in a critical time.
We are fighting here the battle of the free world against the empire of evil. That's what we're doing, and together, that's why together we must stay together.
Meanwhile, U.S. efforts to head off an all-out war between Hezbollah and Israel aren't bearing fruit. Both Hezbollah and the Israeli Defense Forces are ramping up the rhetoric. Israel's defense minister warns the Jewish nation is going to put an end to near daily Hezbollah attacks on northern Israel.
We have an obligation to change the situation in the north and return the citizens safely to their homes, and we will find a way to do this.
Hezbollah's leader says the Iranian-backed terrorist group will hold nothing back if Israel attacks.
If the war is imposed on Lebanon, the resistance will fight without control, without rules, and without a ceiling.
He also threatened to drag Cyprus into the war if that island nation lets Israel's military or civilian jets use its runways. Meanwhile, as Hezbollah's shelling of northern Israel increases, citizens still there are tired and afraid.
It's scary because you don't know when it is coming to you. Suddenly you have an alarm. Suddenly missiles fall.
It is unbearable. It can't be contained. It is impossible to live with it.
Many among the roughly 80,000 Israelis displaced by all the shelling have been hoping they could return home by September 1st, when school starts again. But Israel's chief military spokesman says that's not likely.
Well, I hope the world is listening to Israeli President Herzog when he calls it an empire of evil. Because that's what it is. We're looking at radical Islamic leaders, whether it's Hezbollah or Hamas or Iran or the Houthis in Yemen. They're all united by an ideology that is extreme. It's literally unimaginable for the average American, where someone would be so dedicated to killing Jews that they can't see any other way forward, that Israel has to be wiped off the map.
There is a prophecy that many end-time scholars believe to be a future war involving Israel and the surrounding Muslim nations, as we read in Psalm 83:1-8. Do not keep silent, O God. Do not hold your peace and do not be still, O God. For behold, your enemies make a tumult, and those who hate you have lifted up their head. They have taken crafty counsel against your people and consulted together against your sheltered ones. They have said, Come, and let us cut them off from being a nation, that the name of Israel may be remembered no more. For they have consulted together with one consent. They form a confederacy against you. The tents of Edom and the Ishmaelites, Moab and the Hagrites, Gebal, Ammon, and Amalek, Philistia with the inhabitants of Tyre, Assyria also has joined with them. They have helped the children of Lot. Is it possible Psalm 83 is a future prophecy on the verge of finding fulfillment?
Simmering cross-border tensions between Israel and Lebanon and fears it could be reaching a boiling point. The Israeli army approved plans on Tuesday to launch a military operation in Lebanon after months of deadly rocket attacks and airstrikes between Israel and the militant group Hezbollah. The Iran-backed group sent a warning that Lebanon would be ready to fight a regional war, even though it does not want the war to expand.
Israel knows that no place will be safe from our missiles and our drones, and our strikes are not indiscriminate. Israel knows that we have a list of targets, and we have the ability to reach these targets, and we will shake the foundations of Israel.
For the first time, Nasrallah also threatened to strike Cyprus, an EU country, which has hosted Israeli forces for training drills.
Cyprus should be warned that opening Cypriot bases and airports to the Israelis to target Lebanon means that the Cypriot government has become part of the war.
This comes one day after a U.S. envoy met Lebanese and Israeli officials in a desperate attempt to stop a full-scale conflict. But drone footage released by Hezbollah Tuesday showing potential strike targets in northern Israel prompted the foreign minister to say, in an all-out war, Hezbollah will be destroyed and Lebanon severely beaten. Since the October 7th attacks by Hamas in Israel, cross-border fighting between Hezbollah and the Israeli army has been ongoing, killing at least 16 soldiers and 11 civilians on the Israeli side and over 400 people on the Lebanese side, most of whom were Hezbollah fighters.
Zechariah goes on to tell us that God will use the Israeli Defense Forces to destroy the Muslim nations that seek their destruction. Zechariah 12:6. In that day I will make the governors of Judah like a fire pan in the woodpile, and like a fiery torch in the sheaves. They shall devour all the surrounding peoples on the right hand and on the left, but Jerusalem shall be inhabited again in her own place, Jerusalem. As a sign of his coming and the end of the age, Jesus declares, and you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom.
Right, an eerie display of solidarity between two dangerous rogue regimes as Russia and North Korea sign a new defense agreement to strengthen ties and guarantee military assistance with if each one is attacked. All of this, of course, happening as Biden critics say the president is weakening America's standing on the world stage. Here with reaction is former State Department spokesperson Morgan Ortegas. Morgan, how concerned should we be about this?
Very concerned. It's not something that we should take lightly at all. What you're seeing really form is something that I call a quartet of evil. That's North Korea, Iran, China, Russia getting together. What's important about this defense agreement is they have essentially, the Russians have agreed to come, and North Korea, they've agreed to come to each other's aid if either one is militarily attacked. North Korea has missiles that can reach anywhere in the United States, not just California, not just Hawaii, not just Guam. They have missiles that can reach anywhere in the United States. North Korea also, Brian, is supplying about 10,000 containers of munitions to Russia on a daily, monthly basis for their war in Ukraine. That 10,000 is the total number. So you see North Korea resupplying Russia. What can Russia give to North Korea? They can provide even more advanced, sophisticated weaponry to those missiles, which are already a threat to the United States. So you see something that I like to call, Brian, there's a supply chain of terror coming on. You see North Korea, you see Iran resupplying Russia. And who's the target of all of this? Well, ultimately, it comes down to Americans. Those Iranian-made drones are what killed Americans in January in Jordan. Those Iranian-made drones and ballistic missiles are what the Houthis use to shoot at U.S. ships. So you have to look at Iran, at North Korea, at Russia and China as one entity, one supply chain of terror. And their ultimate goal is the United States, and this defense pact yesterday only made the ties between Russia and North Korea even stronger.
Let's start here with what happened this week, because there's an alliance that we need to pay attention to. Wall Street Journal, here you go. How Putin rebuilt Russia's war machine with help from U.S. adversaries. Iran, North Korea, and China are supplying the people and know-how to tool up Russia's factories and churn out arms for the war in Ukraine. This relationship could be very dangerous for us for a very long time.
Yeah, very much so. 4 days after the State of the Union, our intelligence chiefs came before a scheduled meeting with the Congress, and they said these four countries that you've identified here represent a threat to the United States we haven't seen in multiple decades. In looking at this, what we're really facing is collaboration and cooperation among four distinct allies. China is a near peer competitor, Russia is a chronic threat, Iran seeks domination of the Middle East, and North Korea has a nuclear arsenal with ballistic missiles that can reach the United States. This is serious. We believe at ISW that we haven't seen a threat like this since World War II. Why? Because we could get involved in more than one war in multiple theaters. That is really the issue that we're facing. And here's the problem, Bill. The intelligence chief said this is very serious. We haven't seen it in decades. We're saying we haven't really seen anything like this since World War II. Where is the administration having a frank conversation with the American people about the seriousness of this threat and how it would impact American security? It is not happening. And that is pretty outrageous and shameful.
This, as we continue to see these escalating clashes happening in the Middle East, Trey Yinks just gave us a full report between Israel and Hezbollah. Do you believe that they are inching closer to all-out war?
Yeah, they are. And the Israelis have made up their minds that they need to take a look at the Hezbollah situation. The reality is that 80,000 people who lived in northern Israel have evacuated from northern Israel. And in a sense, Hezbollah has redefined the boundary of northern Israel. Yeah. The Israelis believe they have got to go in there and deal with Hezbollah. They have to push them back across the Litani River. Mm-hmm. This is 18 miles from the border. That is the issue. To push them back, they have two choices. Run an air campaign only, mm-hmm. to obviously bomb them and force them to evacuate, or go in on the ground and also conduct an air campaign. Hezbollah is formidable. Hamas is nowhere near Hezbollah's capability. Hezbollah doesn't have the subterranean tunnel complex. But here's the problem. 150,000 rockets and missiles can reach any town or any city and swarm those towns and cities. A force of close to 100,000, not just a terrorist organization, but organized as military formations with artillery and fighting vehicles. When the Israelis went in there in 2006, after several weeks trying to do the same thing, push the Hezbollah back, after several weeks, the operation had failed, and they retreated out of Lebanon, and all three service chiefs were relieved of duty as a result of it. They know this will be a very tough fight, but they believe they have to do it if they're going to maintain the sovereignty of Israel and have the border that they want to have.
18 years later, it could be a hot summer again in northern Israel. Let's see if that's the case.
It seems as though we are on the verge of World War III. Jesus told us in the last days there would be war between the nations. Are we seeing the stage setting taking place to fulfill this prophecy? If so, then we're close to the time Jesus refers to as the worst time in the history of the world, as we read in Matthew 24:21. For then there will be great tribulation, such as has not been since the beginning of the world until this time, no, nor ever shall be. If we are that close to the tribulation, then the world is about to see war the likes of this planet has never seen before. The book of Revelation tells us when Jesus breaks the first seal, the Antichrist will be unleashed. When Jesus breaks the second seal, war will be unleashed. Resulting from these wars will be famine, pestilence, and death as Jesus breaks the third and fourth seals. The Bible tells us 25% of the population of the earth will be killed at this time, as we read in Revelation 6:8. So I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and the name of him who sat on it was Death, and Hades followed with him. And power was given to them over a fourth of the earth, to kill with sword, with hunger, with death, and by the beasts of the earth. The population of the world is roughly 8 billion, meaning 2 billion people will die during this time. The remaining 17 judgments of God include devastating earthquakes, cosmic disturbances, scorching heat, meteors, 100-pound hailstones, volcanic eruptions, loathsome sores on those who take the mark of the beast, the seas, rivers, and springs of water turn to blood, demons torturing mankind, and a 200 million strong demonic army who will kill another third of mankind, bringing the total to 4 billion. Jesus, speaking to his disciples about the signs of his coming and the end of the age, declares this in Matthew 24:12, and because lawlessness will be increased, the love of many will grow cold. The Bible tells us lawlessness is the violation of God's commandments, as we read in 1 John 3:4. Whoever commits sin also commits lawlessness, and sin is lawlessness. Sin will be so rampant and so commonplace in the last days that the love people once had for one another, for many, will be non-existent. In this prophecy, Jesus Christ is describing an ongoing breakdown in the relationship with God. And since people's love for God is waning, it will be evident in the way people treat one another as well. A symptom may be that the love toward other people is decreasing, but the real cause is that the relationship with God is cooling off. This is what we are witnessing in our world today.
For months, we've been telling you about migrant crime, dangerous illegals who break into the country to fight, kill, and rape. The media and the Democrats say it's not real. But today we have another gruesome example of just how real it is. Rachel Morin was a mother of five living in Maryland. Last August, she was going for a run on a safe, quiet trail when she disappeared. Her body was found on the trail the very next day. Now we're finding out Rachel was raped and murdered by one of Biden's migrants. Victor Martinez Hernandez broke into our country in February of 2023. A month before that, he allegedly killed another woman in El Salvador. A few weeks after crossing the border, he invaded a house in California, attacking a 9-year-old girl and her mother. He was caught on camera escaping the scene of that crime. Then he made his way to the East Coast and killed Rachel. This is the second woman in that county to be killed by a migrant in the last 2 years.
I want to now direct these comments to 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue and to every member in both chambers of Congress. We are 1800 miles away from the southern border, and the American citizens are not safe because of failed immigration policies. This is the second time in just 2 years that an innocent Harford County woman has lost her life to a criminal in our country illegally. And in both cases, they are suspects from El Salvador with ties to criminal gangs.
And it's not just murder. Chris Hansen caught a migrant who was looking to have sex with a teen in a sting operation. Watch this.
Hey, how are you? Take a seat, please. Take a seat. Have a seat. Tomar el asiento. Aquí. You don't know the girl?
No.
Because in the conversation you had with the girl, you said you wanted to have sex with her. Quiero sexo con joven de 15 años.
No.
See? Is in the transcripts.
No.
You talked online. You came over to have oral sex and intercourse.
No.
What do you mean no?
No.
It's in the transcripts.
Proverbs 29:2. When the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. But when a wicked man rules, the people groan.
When there's a major tragedy in the country, the president has a responsibility to address it and assure us he's taking steps so it never happens again. This week, we found out a mother of five was murdered by one of Biden's migrants during an international crime spree. Her name was Rachel Morin. We'll say it, but the president won't. The White House put out a statement saying they send their condolences, but can't comment on active cases. Instead of talking about Rachel and the threat of migrant crime, Biden chose today, of all days, to sign an executive order that helps illegals stay in the country. Amnesty and work visas for 500,000 migrants. If an illegal has been married to a citizen for a while, they're protected. Biden says he's keeping families together. But what about the American ones that were torn apart by migrant criminals? Where's the executive order protecting us? This doesn't even make sense politically. 60% of Americans want every single illegal alien deported. Most Hispanic Americans agree. So why is Joe Biden signing this now? Because he doesn't have a choice. It's what his donors want. Tech giants hire migrants from Asia to fill white-collar American jobs. Big tech thinks Trump's going to win in November and deport all of their workers. They needed an insurance policy.
To start the testimony for the evening, I call Senator Biden of Delaware. Senator Biden, it's nice to have you here. As the youngest member of the Senate, the one, therefore, who may expect the longest career there, I wonder if you'd say to us, since it's clear that you're not corrupt and you got elected, why should people think that the system produces corrupt results when there you are?
Well, I'm not sure you should assume I'm not corrupt, but I thank you for that, though. The system does produce corruption, and I think implicit in the system is corruption, when in fact, whether or not you can run for public office, and it costs a great deal of money to run for the United States Senate, even for a small state like Delaware, you have to go to those people who have money, and they always want something.
Zuckerberg and his buddies lobbied Biden to sign this executive order, and it worked. This isn't about compassion, it's all about money. Biden let it slip today. Watch.
Why the action we're taking today matters, if you wonder about that, just ask business leaders, ask labor leaders, ask economists, ask elected officials. They know it's good for American business. They know it's good for the American economy. They know it's good for America, period.
Migrants help Biden cook the books for his phony jobs reports. If Jose from Guatemala gets hired, Biden says the economy's booming. It's also helping keep wages down because corporations pay illegals next to nothing, undercutting the American worker. Also doesn't hurt that migrants can use a loophole to get away with voting in our elections. It's illegal for migrants to vote, but if they say they thought they were allowed to vote, they can get off. In some states, all you need is an electric bill to register. A migrant can get their hands on that easily. So Democrats win, Biden's donors win, the migrants win, and you lose. Biden calls that the cost of doing business. They sell off our jobs to migrants for pennies on the dollar and let in violent criminals in the process. Then Biden's cronies tell us migrant crime isn't real.
His so-called migrant crime wave is just not happening. It's a lie. An NBC News analysis released just this week found that crime has actually dropped in the cities that received the most migrants from the southern border.
Yeah, right. Migrant crime isn't real. It's everywhere. It doesn't matter how far you are from the border. In New York, a Biden migrant from Ecuador was just arrested for raping a little girl.
Terrifying situation involving that illegal immigrant from Ecuador and that 13-year-old girl. Now, police arrested him early this morning. Police say the 25-year-old man raped a 13-year-old girl in Casina Park in Fresh Meadows last week. The girl was with a 13-year-old boy playing in the park when the man approached them with a knife. Police also say he forced them into the woods where he tied them up, and that's when he sexually assaulted the young girl.
We call him a person of interest.
Mm-hmm.
We should call him the devil.
The migrant was chased down by Good Samaritans. They roughed up the perv while he tried hiding under a car.
About 3 miles from the crime scene in Corona, residents there recognized him from the neighborhood. They say they all waited for him at this bodega on 108th Street, where he often went, before attacking him.
Boom. He comes. We caught him. Spot him, got him.
We just happened to see the suspect, and we acted accordingly.
I need to do something because it's just not right, and I got two little sisters. I'm about to have a daughter, and that's just not right.
In Colorado, a migrant plowed his semi-truck into another driver.
The man behind the wheel of this 18-wheeler that investigators say caused this crash near Conifer last week never should have been driving. Immigration and Customs Enforcement had ordered Ignacio Cruz Mendoza to leave the U.S. 16 times since 2002, 22 years ago. He was arrested again in Jefferson County for a number of charges, including not having a commercial driver's license. Investigators say Cruz Mendoza's truck crossed into oncoming traffic, lost its load, and hit 5 vehicles. One driver was killed in the crash.
Biden can't keep pretending migrant crime doesn't exist. Americans are losing their lives. Rachel Morin had a long life ahead of her. She was a mother, a sister, a daughter. And if that illegal hadn't taken her life, she would have been a grandmother. Her oldest daughter is expecting a child later this year.
Faye told me that she's going to introduce a little girl into the world later this year. It's a happy moment and a sad moment, too, because Rachel should be here for that moment. And Faye should be able to give that news to Rachel, to tell Rachel you're going to be a grandmother. But she can never give that news.
It's time for Biden to say her name and do his job.
2 Timothy 3:1-13. But know this, that in the last days, perilous times will come. For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power. And from such people, turn away. For of this sort are those who creep into households and make captives of gullible women, loaded down with sins, led away by various lusts, always learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now as Jannes and Jambres resisted Moses, so do these also resist the truth, men of corrupt minds, disapproved concerning the faith. But they will progress no further, for their folly will be made manifest to all, as theirs also was. But you have carefully followed my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, love, perseverance, persecutions, afflictions, which happened to me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra, what persecutions I endured. And out of them all, the Lord delivered me. Yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. But evil men and imposters will grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. The signs of Jesus' soon return are so strong now, and the evidence is so clear, that any person willing to accept the truth can see that the end of the world as we know it is near. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But God demonstrates his own love toward us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. These are the ABCs of salvation. A. Admit that you're a sinner. B. Believe in your heart that Jesus Christ died for your sins, was buried, and God raised him from the dead. C. Call upon the name of the Lord, and you will be saved. Jesus paid the price for mankind's sin. He has provided a way to spend eternity with him and the Father. All you have to do is believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved. God has already done all the work. All you must do is receive, in faith, the salvation God offers. Fully trust in Jesus alone as the payment for your sins. Believe in him, and you will not perish. God is offering you salvation as a gift. All you have to do is accept it. Jesus is the only way of salvation. That being said, we must repent of our sins. While repentance is not a work that earns salvation, repentance unto salvation does result in works. It is impossible to truly and fully change your mind without that causing a change in action. In the Bible, repentance results in a change in behavior. Repentance, properly defined, is necessary for salvation.
One day, Jesus is coming. You may be at church. You may be at work. You may be asleep. God grant that you will be ready when he makes his personal appearance. My God, what if his appearance occurs on a Sunday morning? My prophetic word to you this morning is get ready! Get ready!
Time is short. Call upon the name of Jesus today.